It's January 28, 2024. Welcome to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church in Maple, Ontario. My name is Alan Kay. I want to welcome you all to our service today. And we have a special guest leading us in worship today. I'll talk about Jim in a second, but just a couple of housekeeping items. Just remember, if you have a change in any of your information, please fill out that little card that's in the pew, put it in the offertory basket, and that way we can update our information. If there are little tick boxes, if you want us to contact you about anything in particular, and we would be happy to have somebody contact you in that regard. And then just to remember that we'll talk about more in the announcements, but there is a special congregational meeting. That's part of the reason why Jim is here. And that'll be following the service. There will be a lunch following the service instead of fellowship, and then we'll be having that meeting as soon as Reverend Weiss can get to our church as well. So today we're going to be led in worship by Dr. Reverend Jim Czegledi. And so Jim's been an ordained minister for over more than 35 years. He served Congregation Ontario and was Associate Secretary of the National Office of the Presbyterian Church in Canada. He's a graduate of Bishop's University, Knox College, and Pittsburgh Theological Seminary. So he's got a lot of experience, and that's where you're going to find out about this congregational meeting. He's going to be doing some finding out all about what makes you come to St. Andrew's here in Maple and some other questions. So look forward to hearing more from Jim as Jim leads us in today's worship. Welcome, Jim. You're called to worship.
Thank you. Good morning.
Morning.
God's praise endures forever.
And eternity meets us in fleeting moments.
God's praise endures forever.
And glory bursts into ordinary activities.
God's praise endures forever.
And faith is steadfast in the midst of change and challenge.
Let us worship the eternal God who calls us to this time and place.
So our opening hymn is Follow Me, the Master Said. It's number 645 in your blue hymn book. Please stand if you are able.
Though the world my daily round of care, as I talk with God in prayer, with the cross which I must bear, I will follow Jesus. Ever keep the end in view, I will follow Jesus. All his promises are true, I will eternal I have won. I will follow Jesus.
Pray with me. Transforming God, you take the night and give us day. You take our strife and give us peace. You take our sadness and give us joy. You take our fear and give us courage. You take death and give us new life. O God, you give and you give, and we come to praise you and offer to you our love and loyalty as your willing servants. In the name of Christ, who enriches our lives with grace, and in the power of the Spirit, who prays within us when we cannot find the right words to honor you. You are kind and gracious. Trusting in your faith, we place our mission and our lives in your hand, and give us gifts, we ask, to accomplish the amazing things you have promised us in Christ. For we confess sometimes that we have taken credit for what your love has done for us and for others. Sometimes we are called by our own desires and our own will, not yours. Sometimes we step back and let others carry responsibilities when we should help carry some burdens. Forgive us, we ask, when we have failed to honor your trust in us, we pray. For hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ, and Christ has died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us so that God's promises in him may be made real and true, and that we are forgiven and given a new start by God's grace. In Christ we ask and gather. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. It is wonderful for me to be with you this morning. I look forward to our time of worship together. And following worship, I got a glimpse of the lunch that is going to be served. So I want to encourage everybody to come and share in the fellowship time and meeting time that we will have immediately following the worship this morning. Again, wonderful to be with you this morning. At this time, I understand we exchange the peace of Christ, and may the peace of Christ be with your spirit.
And also with yours.
As we exchange the peace of Christ.
Peace, everybody.
Now, it's my understanding also at this time, we have a children's time. So if the children, do they come up front?
They'll come up to the front row.
They come up to the front. Can you still hear me if I come up to the front? Because I have a history lesson to share with the children and for all of us this morning. They come running. Wonderful. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, who run after it, for they shall be filled. God bless them. Thank you for reminding us of that truth. So I've got a history lesson that probably goes back maybe 10 years. That's a long time in history, because some of you maybe aren't much older than 10 years old, and some of you maybe aren't quite 10 yet. But this story may go back even 10, 15 years, if you can imagine how long ago in history that could be. And it goes back to the time when we had maps in our cars. Can anybody remember those times when we had maps in our cars? Now, do you know what a map is? Yeah, what's a map? Exactly. A map is a piece of paper where you can locate where you are and where you want to go. That answer couldn't have been any better, so thank you very much. But now, not many of us have maps. We just pull out our phones, type in our address like I did a few months ago when I first came to St. Andrews Maple, and it showed me exactly where to go, and it told me where to turn when I had my phone on. But before we had these phones in our pockets, we used to have maps that would tell us what road to take, what way to take, and it would also tell us where we are. Well, friend, we are thankful that God still has maps for us. And we call this map a Bible, because the Bible is also a map for us. It tells us where we are, and it tells us where we are going with Jesus. It tells us what road we are on. It tells us about roads, the road of love, the road of peace, the road of forgiveness, the road that Jesus tells us about, which he calls the way. So just like this map tells us what road we're on and which way we are going and where we are, the Bible tells us too. It tells us of Jesus' love for us, that Jesus forgives our sins, and that Jesus will lead us and guide us and be our friend. So the map in many ways is like, the Bible rather, in many ways is like a life for us, a map for us also, the map of life. It shows us the road to take, the road, the way of Jesus. And it's my great prayer that you will always remember this, and that you will always follow, and all of us will always follow the road, the way of Jesus. Pray with me. Lord God, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for your love, your peace, your grace, which we have in Jesus, which the Bible tells us about. May we be true to him in life, at school, and at play. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Amen.
Now, Alan, at this time, the children go for it. They can go back to their seats. Wonderful. Thank you very much for helping me out on the story.
Oh, welcome, Rajat, up to read scripture for us. But I think he has a quick testimony to give before.
Yes, indeed, I do. Thank you so much for having me today. It's a privilege. So before I begin, I'd like to share a personal story and a testimony about God's influence in our lives. My father was a devout Christian. And it's his passing about 3 months ago that brought me and my family to this church to help find peace and comfort, which I believe we have over the course of three months. Nobody here at the church knows this, but the readings that I've been incidentally assigned to read today are the very same ones that were passed down to my sister and I in a handwritten note many years ago. They have a deep connection and meaning in our lives. And I just want to share that with the church, because what may seem as a coincidence, I believe and see to be a proof of God's grace and his guiding hand shaping the path of our lives. Let us pray. Loving God, attend to us as we open your word. May our hearts and spirits listen for your will for us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
The first reading is from the book of Psalm, chapter 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in the green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yes, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The second reading is from the book of John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 14. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am the Father, and I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Amen.
This is the word of our Lord.
Thank you very much, Ramajat, for that wonderful testimony and reading. And now back to Jim for our sermon.
Wonderful reading and testimony to the sovereignty of God, knowing that these scriptures were going to be read today, is a testament to the very sovereignty of God. Pray with me. Now in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, world without end. Amen.
Amen.
A funny thing happened to me when I drove up to Maple a couple of weeks ago for a meeting. I got stuck in traffic on Major McKenzie.
What a surprise.
Has this ever happened to you?
All the time.
I hate traffic. I find nothing good about sitting there in my car, burning gas and going nowhere. But one thing I noticed as I was stopped on the road was a simple sign that said, yield. And I don't like to yield. Letting people into my lane doesn't bother me so much as trying to get over into another lane. I'm always worried about, will I get hit by that person? Will somebody shake their fist at me or hit me and cause an accident? I hate to yield. I once heard a sermon preached by a minister who said that once he served a rural congregation, and when he was out visiting one day, he used to go on a road that was over a river that had a narrow bridge that only had one lane. So when you went on one side of the bridge, you had to stop and wait for any oncoming traffic. But the thing of it is he had to do the same thing on the other side. When he returned, he had to pull over and yield or wait to see if there was any oncoming traffic coming from the other side. And he said he didn't like to yield both ways. Now, in faith terms, many of us don't like to yield either, because yielding constantly asks us the question of the Christian faith. What part or what decision in my life do I need to yield to God to? What is God calling me to do at this time? And what do I need to yield to make that happen? What is God calling me to be now? And what is it that I have to yield in my own life to make this happen? Because yield means to give way. To give way. It means to give way to another position, another way, or another attitude. It means to give way to their power, their influence, or their approach. It means admitting that maybe they are right, or at least they have the right of way. It means to change. To change our thoughts, to change our beliefs, to change our ways. Yield means to surrender your position. And no one likes to surrender. Recently, my wife and I went on a vacation, and we were at the Toronto airport, and you know, you have to stand in front of that machine that circles around you to see if there's any metal as a metal detector, and you have to raise your hands as that machine makes a couple of laps around you. And there you stand, totally helpless, totally vulnerable, surrendering. And then the thought came to me as I stood in the middle of that machine, is this is exactly the position, this is exactly the attitude that we have when we surrender to the will and to the presence of Almighty God. Completely defenseless, completely vulnerable, completely at God's mercy. And this is what it means also to completely surrender. I remember as a boy of 5 or 6 years old, learning to read. And my parents, with 4 kids in the car, as we would travel up to the cottage or go on trips around the city, would do a very wonderful thing. They would point to the road signs and ask us to read them. Now, being the youngest of the 4, I got the easier ones to read. But still, this is how I learned to read Bayview Avenue and Keel Street and Bathurst and Dufferin as I sat in the back seat of the car. And then one day we were driving, and I'll never forget this. I saw a sign, and it read, "Yield to Presbyterians." And I thought this was pretty good, only to discover later that the sign actually said, "Yield to pedestrians." And for a moment there, Jackie in the back of the car, I thought being a Presbyterian was pretty good. You know, you see these signs, and maybe cars would just let you into their lane like you were an emergency vehicle or something, and you would just have the right of way. But I was wrong. You see, I read the sign wrong. I didn't read it right. Signs show us the way to go, the way to follow, but we have to read them right. And as we sit in traffic, we can learn a lot about reading the road signs of life as well as the road signs of the highways and byways of life. In the Greek New Testament, the way, which was read earlier today in the scriptures, simply means road, hodos from the Greek. It simply means the way of faith, the way of Christ. The early Christians, before they were called Christians, were simply called the people of the way, followers of the way of Christ. And in the 1970s, there was a popular translation of the Bible, particularly written for young people and older children, simply known as the Way. Jesus himself this morning declares for us that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus in John's Gospel declares that I am the way, the truth, and the life. He declares for us that he is the way, the road, or the highway to God, our heavenly creator. He is the way to heaven and to be in full communion with God. And this shouldn't surprise us, because Jesus' characteristic call in all of the Gospels is to follow me, to follow him on the way of faith, the way of discipleship. And disciple simply means to be a follower, to be a follower on the way and of the way. In the familiar reading of the 23rd Psalm this morning, we are reminded that God leads us in paths, ways of righteousness for his name's sake. And like a shepherd who leads his flock and shows them the way they are to go to avoid the pitfalls and perils of life, so does Christ lead us on the way. John 14 and Psalm 23 read this morning are also correctly identified, are passages that we hear at funerals. And tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock, I will have a funeral to conduct tomorrow in the city. And I will read these passages again to the people that gather at that service, reminding them and reminding us always that God leads us in paths of righteousness for God's name's sake. For even though we walk in the valley of the shadow of death, God leads us. And we are reminded of that when we follow God, when we follow Christ on the way, on the path of righteousness. Today, my focus isn't so much only about the destination, the promised land to be with God eternally at the end of the way, but also on the journey to get there, on the path, or on the road, or on the way to get there. Because for me, more than anything else, the Christian faith is a way of life. It's a way of believing. It's a way of acting. It's a way of thinking. It is a way of life. It is the way to God, the way of salvation, and the way to eternal peace. And the Word of God shows us the way to God. We heard it again this morning, that the Word shows us the way. The Word points to the way. It testifies to it. And we gather to worship and to witness to it in our lives. I once heard on TV a pompous preacher say, that my way is Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, as you know, is a Hebrew word for God. Now, a more selfless approach to faith declares for us that Yahweh is the way. Not my way is Yahweh. Yonge Street in Toronto, not terribly far from here, just to our due east, is reputed to be the longest street in the world. It starts at Lake Ontario, and it goes all the way up to Northern Ontario. It is claimed to be the longest road, the longest street in the world. But I think the longest street, the longest road, the longest way in the world is the way of Christ, which leads us here to the hereafter. It begins when we are born and sees us through until we are reunited with Christ and our Heavenly Father. That road leads us from here to eternity. Now, at the end of a funeral that I conducted a couple of years ago, they played the deceased person's favorite song after the funeral was concluded. And it was Frank Sinatra's song, I Did It My Way. And after playing it, I thought to myself, is this really the way we ought to live our lives? Are we ought to live our lives only my ways? Shouldn't we live our lives Christ's way and on the road of Christ? Because society prides itself on never compromising, never giving way, never giving in, and never surrendering, of doing things my way. So do we live life just for personal gain? Or just for our financial or political gain? Do we really do things my way? Or do we strive to live life Christ's way? Now, I once met a person whose favorite expression was my way or the highway. And he really wasn't joking when he said that. Again, is this really the way we ought to live our lives, where all of our needs come first and last? Because the road to the way of Christ takes us in a different direction, a different route. Because the way of God is found through yielding. And if you could summarize my sermon this morning in one sentence and remember it, it would simply be this, that the way to the way is through yielding. And I'm thrilled this morning that you in your bulletins have a space where you can write down the summary of the what you may have learned in the sermon. And I pray that you would all write this down and you would all remember this, that the way to the way is through yielding. You don't have to write it down right now. Think of it as a homework assignment. To give way to the way. To yield our lives as Christ yielded his life to the will of God for us, who gave it up for us all, giving up our selfish ways and yielding to God and becoming more selfless. Now, it's impossible to be 100% selfless in life. We need to first care for ourselves in order to care for others. And self-care is one of those things that we can only do for ourselves. No one else can do that for us. And we care for ourselves and our souls and our bodies when we get nurtured by the word and get inspired to do acts of righteousness and discipleship in response to hearing the word. And in response to hearing the word, yielding to that word, we go out into the world and to the community and seek to faithfully serve Christ. So my question for you this morning is, our first thought always a selfish thought, or is it a selfless thought? And the question is, are we always selfish? Do we always look after ourselves first? Or are we predisposed to be selfless? Are we open and predisposed to yielding in life? Our thoughts, our attitudes, our actions. The Apostle Paul, in another place in the New Testament, tells us that we should pray without ceasing. But what does this mean? How can we possibly pray 100% of the time? We can't. It's impossible. But what Paul is saying to us here is really that we should always be predisposed, inclined to pray. That we should always yield to prayer. And in the same manner also, are we to be predisposed, inclined to acts of selflessness and service, where we first yield to what God wants, just like how Christ yielded his life for us. It is to follow the road sign to yield on the way to Christ and on the road of life. Many years ago, I was on a flight from Vancouver returning to Toronto, and the plane hit some incredible amount of turbulence like I had never seen before. It was as if the plane fell several hundred feet in just a few seconds, and even the doors and the containers above popped open, and a few handbags fell out. And some people thought that the plane was going to crash and we were all going to perish. And a man sitting a few seats in front of me raised his hand and faithfully said, "Lord, I am ready. Take me." You see, he was predisposed to faith. His life was predisposed for Christ, to yield his life to Christ. And this is how we should presuppose our lives of faith, to constantly ask ourselves the question, how can I yield? And I'll close this morning by telling you a story about one evening I visited a young couple who were joining my church when I served it in Toronto. And they lived in a beautiful condominium right on the edge of the 401 by Bayview Avenue. And at night, if you've ever seen the 401 at night when it's dark out, it is the most spectacular highway to see, because all you see are a steady stream of lights when they're not stuck in traffic, of course. And it's like a river of lights that is flowing. It's almost like a river of life. And what caught my attention were all these cars that were trying to merge onto the highway, how they were trying to pick up speed and merge to get in. Sometimes drivers would yield and allow them to come in, and at other times it was more of a struggle. And that reminded me of my life also, of how I strive to yield my life for Christ and how hard it is for me sometimes to do it, most of the time, in fact. But when we do this, we live in the steady flow of God's grace and God's mercy when we yield our way to the way. And this enables us to live and to strive in the way of Christ's light and love. And I pray this morning that as we drive home and maybe even get stuck in traffic on the way, that we will be able to read the road signs of life and faith and continue to be faithful followers of Christ, who is the way on earth, all the way to our heavenly home. Amen.
Amen.
Pray with me. Lord, our God, we give to you our thanks and praise that you have shown us the way in life. And we pray, Lord, that we would continue to be your faithful followers, your servants, to see the signs that point to you and lead to your grace. For in Christ we ask. Amen. The hymn of praise is, "Will You Come and Follow Me?" The hymn is number 634.
Please stand if you're capable.
Freely have we been given, and freely do we also give. Your offerings will now be received.
Hey, Don, partnership with Canada Helps. You can go to www.canadahelps.org. /EN/EN/56495. Or donations can be mailed or delivered to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church, 1860 Neal Street, Vaughan, Ontario, L6A, 4.
those who are interested in just donating automatically on a monthly basis, you can sign up for PAR. Like, if you do that, please send an email to the church office at St. Andrew's Press Maple at Belnet. That's for St. without the apostrophe, but with the S, Press for Presbyterian, and Maple for the family.
Let us stand for the doxology.
Eternal and gracious God, we give to you some of what we have and pray, Lord, that you would continue to use these gifts and us in service of your way here on earth. In Christ we pray. Amen.
And it's announcement time. Morning again, everybody. So we got quite a list of announcements. I'm going to throw them up on the board for those at home. So starting, we have immediately after the service, we have mission lunch. And that will be any donations for that lunch will be in support of PWSND. So God's Presbyterian World Service and Development. So I want to thank anybody who chooses to make a donation for that. That's a wonderful thing. And thank you very much. Then we'll be having our congregational meeting, a special meeting, and that I'm going to put the announcement up, so because we have to do this properly for meetings. So the session hereby notifies the congregation of an important congregational meeting to be held on Sunday, January 28, immediately following the worship service for the purposes of discussing the future of St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church here in Maple. Our interim moderator, Reverend Dr. Heather Weiss, has invited Presbytery-appointed congregational consultant, you just met him, Reverend Dr. Jim Czegledi, to interview the congregation. Please plan to attend. This is the third of three notices. So friends, just a reminder about that. So we do look forward to getting your feedback. Just give us those honest answers. This is an opportunity to give some honest answers to some questions. So I look forward to seeing you all after. So join us for lunch and then can stay on for that meeting. Then our next session meeting will be held on February 5th, 2024 at 7:30 p.m. So if you have any issues that you want to speak with your elder about to bring up that session, please speak to one of the elders. And our next Sunday school will be held on February 18th, 2024 during the regular service. And we've set the date for our annual congregational meeting as March 10th, 2024. And that similarly will follow the regular service on that day. Just a reminder of a couple of the regular announcements that we have every week, which is just a reminder that we do support the Vaughan Food Bank. And so any food donations are appreciated. And there is a basket in the fellowship hall if you want to bring in some non-perishable food items for that basket. And of course, we always have looking for volunteers, and that could be ushers, that could be helping look after the grounds, and also things like reading, just like Rajat did today. So thank you again for all of your help and support in that regard. And one of my favorite parts of the service is the mission moment. I'm going to share that again for the people at home. In Nepal, Nirba struggled with an undiagnosed skin condition that kept her inside. In addition to her health struggles, Nirba grappled with financial instability because she couldn't afford medical assistance. Nirba borrowed money from friends and relatives. We all probably many of us may have been in that kind of a situation. Thanks to a clinic set up by the International Lapel Fellowship, a PWSND partner, Nerva was able to meet with a dermatologist, receive a diagnosis of leprosy, and begin treatment. The clinic's support also provided financial aid for Nerva's child's education. Nerva expressed profound gratitude for this assistance, as it has not only helped her son, but her own health situation as well. So friends, just a reminder that when you are giving to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church, whether it's online or through your envelope, that there are those options for filling in to support mission work and things like Presbyterian World Service and Development. All the donations that we receive for those purposes go to those purposes. And again, reminder that today's lunch is going to, any donations received for it will be going to PWSND. And now let me turn it. Oh, yes. And thank you all for those who brought food. I hadn't seen the spread, but according I heard Jim say that it was looking very good. So I'm looking forward to it and enjoying it with you. And, you want to do communion? Okay. And I got Jackie talking in my ear. She says, just a reminder, next week's service is communion. So let me turn it back to Jim for prayers of intercession, etc.
Pray with me. Wise and generous God, you are the great sovereign of our lives. And we are thankful this day for all that you provide to sustain us. You call our weary souls to rest when the world seems busy. You bless us with the promise of new life. And you gather us around tables of friendship to draw near to one another. Thank you for your signs of goodness and mercy that we can treasure day after day. This day, Lord, we bring to you our own prayers. We pray for others, for our friends and enemies, for our neighbors and strangers alike. We pray for people who are struggling with illness, loneliness, grief, or sadness. And we pray, Lord, for people in countries and in communities where it is not safe to live out their faith or express their views openly. Walk with them, we ask, through these dark days and steep valleys. We pray for victims of discrimination and acts of hatred, for those who fear violence day after day. We pray for all of the innocents of this world, for all those who suffer from the atrocities of wars in the Middle East and the Ukraine and around the world. We pray, Lord, that all would hear your word of peace. We pray, Lord, that there would be an immediate ceasefire and that all suffering would come to an end. We pray also, Lord, for our family and friends and for ourselves. We pray for our trials, our temptations. Pray, Lord, that you'd be with us in a special way, that you would give us strength and courage and hope to persevere on the way. And we pray for your great mission on earth, both here and in other countries. For in silence this day, Lord, do we pray for those who remain in special need of our prayer. Those known to us and to you who are struggling, we now name through the silence of our prayers. Walk with us, we ask, through these dark days and steep valleys. For we offer these prayers and our unspoken concerns to you, In the name of Jesus Christ, who we proclaim as King of our lives and Sovereign of our church, and who has taught us to pray, saying together,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those that sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
All the way my Savior leads me. The hymn of praise is hymn number 699. Please stand if you are able.
It'll be just verses 1 and 3, please.
Verses 1 and 3.
All the way my Savior leads me, what have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divine his comfort, here by faith in him to dwell.
Gracious God, bless us and the food that has been prepared for us to our use and to your service. And now by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with you now and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen. And friends, on behalf of the session here at St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church, I want to thank Jim for leading us in today's worship, and I thank him in advance for leading us in the congregational meeting this afternoon and to doing that wonderful work. I want to thank Rajat for giving that wonderful testimony. It really hit the heart, and I'm sure you felt it as much as I. And thanks all to our other volunteers to help in today, Jackie, etc. And for those who are able to stay, look forward to joining you at the mission lunch. And for those who have to leave us, may you now go in peace.
God will go with you.
Thank you all and have a blessed week.